terms. And that's now going too far as an introductory lecture is concerned, but the relevant keywords here now are that the classifying numbers can be obtained as winding numbers or Chern parities in cases where these are Z2 insulators. And they can be computed typically in terms of certain integrals you do. So when you have given the ground state and you have given the Brillouin zone, then you know for each value in the Brillouin zone what is the corresponding ground state. And for example, in the anomalous quantum Hall case we discussed, a winding number can be obtained by computing, say, over the momentum Brillouin zone torus, this piece here, and you will recognize this perhaps, I mean, this is the vector on the sphere, the eigenstate vector. This is essentially the winding number. How often, it's called Chern number in this case. I mean, how often the eigenstate winds around the sphere. Or in the case of the Zuschriefer-Heger chain, we had this little Q here. We had the curve in the Brillouin zone, in the complex plane as a function of the Brillouin zone. And this winding number is then computed in this way. So these are details now, but I mean, just know that there are in abstract terms mathematicians who never calculate anything, but they just classify, or not just, but they classify. They will tell us whether something can be topological, yes or no. And then it is up to us to actually compute these numbers in concrete terms. There's a machinery, and it would get me now too far to discuss this in more detail. Up to this point, question? Any question? No? Good. Let me throw one more, I mean, of these general facts at you. What can we say about this homotopy approach in general terms? First of all, I mean, it's very general. So it, if you want to classify topology, independence of what momentum plays a role, spatial dimension, and the symmetries, it will give you the full answer, and I tell you what the full answer is in a second. However, there is also downsides. it is arguably very abstract, right? I mean, maybe you don't find it abstract, what I'm saying. I find it relatively abstract. And there's one more thing. Topological insulators, once you have classified one, I'll give you an SSH insulator of winding number one. I mean, who cares? I mean, that's just a number. What makes them interesting is the boundary physics. And this homotopic approach, because it always takes a Brillouin zone, I mean, essentially a bulk object as a fundamental object, it usually doesn't know, or it's ill-suited to the constructively described boundary physics. So if you actually want to know how does the conducting boundary evolve from a topological insulator, this homotopy approach is not of too much use. Yeah? And I'll explain something more useful in a second in this regard. But before getting there, there is a machinery in math known as category theory, or K-theory. And the thing is that these maps from Torrey into Grassmannian can be classified, or their zoology can be understood in extremely general terms, in terms of certain exact sequences. And what mathematicians essentially came up to, but it was then imported into physics by colleagues, is what is called the periodic table of topological insulators. So what is this? This is a table based on this, conceptually based on this homotopy classification, and it does the following. It has as rows, it has the 10 symmetry classes, as we introduce them, 10 different options, and as columns, dimensions, 0, 1, 2, 3. We like to go beyond 3, certainly, but also beyond 9, to expose a certain periodic structure in this table. So what this table does now is, suppose, I mean, you give me an A3 insulator, yeah? We know it's chiral insulator, and we are interested in it in two dimensions. So then we look into the table, we find a zero. And that tells us, no way, there is no topological insulator in class A3 in two dimensions. It just doesn't exist. However, if we go to one dimension, like in our Z2 case, in our SSH case, yes, there are topological invariants. So for each pairing of dimension and symmetry class, the table answers us whether there is a topologically non-trivial situation possible. We can find ground states with twist, etc., or not, if it is possible, that still leaves us with a room as to what the different, what the possible invariants are. And there are two fundamental options. Either you get an integer number, whatever number you compute will be one of the integers. Or you just have a binary alternative, like step two. Yeah. So either, an index which just jumps 0 to 1. These Z2s are a little bit more involved in their description, and I don't do this, but I'm sure you will hear more about them later this week. And notice this diagonal structure here, right? I mean, there is this perfect symmetry in these diagonals here, and that can be understood in various ways, and I will introduce one of them a little later. Anyway, so that is probably the most essential piece of information you want to have in your mind when it comes to topological insulators. I mean, this table, look it up every time. Clear to this point? Yeah?
So there's Z2, which is 0 and 1, and also 2Z.
Yeah, occasionally have only an even, naturally an even number, even integer as in. But then you can rescale. some of these invariants naturally come out as even numbers.
Okay.
Andre, do you know are there two even these 2Z insulators? Is there any significance to the 2? No, but you know the periodic table. You're supposed to know. And if there is a 2Z, is it of any relevance? Okay. If he doesn't know, no. Yeah.
Another question.
Yeah.
In zero dimensions,
yes.
How can I imagine
the
boundary?
Oh, the boundary is then empty. Yeah. There is no. Forget the zero column. Forget it just.
Okay.
Good. More questions, maybe? Okay. One detailed information. This is invented by mathematicians in terms of category theory, which means. A category theory sends the number of bands to infinity in our language. So it's an asymptotic result. There are some rare insulators which are outside this table, some obscure, not obscure, but some extremely, I know actually only of one example, which essentially rely on the value of the number of bands, two bands or three bands, and are outside this table and still topological. You can forget this remark if you want. But to 99.5%, this does the job. Yeah. Good. So, if there are no more questions, then next approach to classifying. I mean, you can ask why do we need another approach? The thing is that. I better connect this. The thing is that this homotopy approach is just a little bit too abstract to be of. Of use in daily life. I mean, when you actually work with a real system, there are better things we can do. Or not better, alternative, let's put it like this. And one approach which is very powerful is the Dirac-Hamiltonian approach. So what do I mean by that? See, suppose we have again our A3, consider the A3 case, yeah? The band structure for either T larger than mu or T smaller than mu had a gap. Looked like this blue curve here. And I introduced here a little parameter R. R is meant to be as a control parameter that triggers the passage from one topological sector to the other. For example, the ratio of T and mu would be the example of such a parameter R. Yeah? But what happens categorically is in a topological or non-topological phase, an insulating phase, you have a gap in the band structure. If you want to go to another topological sector by playing with a system parameter, you have to close the gap. We saw that, right? Closing the gap typically occurs, or actually generically occurs, at zeros in the Brillouin zone, somewhere the spectrum closes, and it closes in the first order zero. Yeah? So you have point-like singularity. So if you have a point-like singularity in a spectrum, you know that there is an effective Hamiltonian with a linear dispersion that describes the vicinity of this point. And that's a Dirac-ish type Hamiltonian, yeah, as we know. So let me illustrate this on an example. The SSH chain, which we discussed, the Hamiltonian, remember, was given by this structure here. Now, R here is now scaled to be the ratio, here, I've set just mu to 1 and t to r. So r equals 1 is a critical point where they are of the same size. The spectrum closes. You can, right, if you put here 1 at k equals 0, you get here 0. So it's a critical point or a closing point. So what we can do then, if we are interested here in particular in this region, and that's where the actual physics takes place now, we can linearize in k around that point. So if we linearize, I mean, r is now close to 1, yeah? Let me write r as 1 plus m. M is small, like mass, yeah? And here for e to the ik, I write 1 plus ik, because I'm interested in small k. So if I do that, my Dirac Hamiltonian, which in the Pauli matrix notation has this form, sigma 1 and sigma 2, assumes the form m times sigma 1, this is just mm here, plus ik times sigma 2. And that's like a 1D version of a Dirac. Yeah? Here's a mass sitting, and here's a linear spectrum. And that describes, in this particular case here, these two legs here in the spectrum. Okay? Now we can ask, why do we do this? Because these Dirac representatives are very convenient to work with, and you can get a load of physics from them without too much work. That's the short answer. So let me illustrate this on a few points. Let's see. How much time do I have, roughly?
15.
Yeah, 20, 25 would. But everybody is tired, I see. But I have that in mind. Yeah, me too. So let me, this is one example of the Dirac approach. Let me go, without going into too much detail, just highlight a few, salient features of this way of describing topological systems. One is, it is usually rather convenient to use such Dirac representatives for the computation of winding numbers or topological invariants. And let me very briefly flash this here on one example, on the example of this SSH. Remember, there was a winding number, and it was just the number of times this beast here winds around zero in the complex plane, which can be represented as this integral, winding number integral. Now we can equivalently represent, if you compare these two formulas, you can write this as the inverse of the Hamiltonian. What does it mean, inverse of the Hamiltonian? The Hamiltonian doesn't have a gap. It is a regular matrix. It doesn't have zero eigenvalue. We can invert it, unless we are at the critical point. So these formulas are equivalent. Take this Hamiltonian, compute the inverse, multiply it with the momentum derivative of this matrix, multiply by Pauli matrix sigma 3, and compute the integral over k. That gives you the winding number. Now, if I go to the Dirac representation, I plug in this effective Dirac formula, use this for my Hamiltonian, and I just throw it in, I get this simple integral, minus 1 over 4 pi I integral from minus infinity to plus infinity. I mean, k is now is linearized, so it's effectively is no longer on the circle, it just lives on the line. I times this integral m over m squared plus k squared. And that integral we can all do. And we find that it is 1/2 times sigma m. So if m is positive, we get 1/2. If m is negative, we get minus 1/2. Now, that doesn't make sense. We should get an integer number, right? I mean, it's supposed to be an integer number. What happens here is that what the Dirac approach actually predicts for us is the jump, the proper jump by 1 from one topological sector to the other. It tells us, the number jumps by 1, namely from plus 1/2 minus 1/2 equals 1. But it doesn't get the number itself right. That happens very often in working with the with Dirac's. And the reason is the following. This was our full winding number integral in full glory over the full Brillouin, right? If we go to the Dirac representation, we somehow assume that we are very close to this hotspot. M is very small, and we can effectively linearize the integral in this way, as an integral over the entire k-axis. Yeah. So that number, what we get, misses the contributions from here. And these contributions are existent. They give us a plus 1/2, in fact, but they're also boring. What what happens out here doesn't change if this curve crosses zero. This just the physics takes place here. Here's where the jump is actually taking place. And that's what the Dirac approach correctly predicts. Yep. No, thank you for the question. I mean, we are close to a gap closing, but it's not yet closed. And the distance from the gap closing is described by a mass in the Dirac Hamiltonian. Yeah, so it's a massive Dirac which becomes massless at criticality. Yes. So that happens, but we can sort of live with that. I mean, this is here the boring contribution. What they correctly reproduce is the jump. Then there is one more thing, maybe somewhat technical, but very important from a practical point of view. Dirac Hamiltonians are simple, right? They have linear and K. I mean, what could be simpler? It's much nicer than some obscure band structure, which is very complicated. That's just a linear function in K. The price you have to pay when working with Diracs in describing topological matter, you often run into ultraviolet problems. They are notorious in Dirac physics, right? You integrate over three-dimensional momentum something which is only linear or which has linear structure. So you often get ultraviolet singularities. Now, in particle physics, where they work a lot with Diracs, there is all kinds of regularization procedures around for working with Diracs. Here we get them for free because we know that our Diracs always come from some band structure. And to regularize them, we only have to remember that, we just remember that this is just a Taylor expansion to leading order. We can include the next leading order term, typically, and get something which is ultraviolet finite. To illustrate this here, we could expand to second order in K, plus K squared, in which case our mass would pick up a K squared contribution. And that K squared regularizes away any ultraviolet singularities. And this is also how, side remark, how to deal with properly deal with anomalies and all kinds of such stuff. I mean, so the problem is nicely ultraviolet regularized and yet simple. It doesn't get simpler where topology is concerned, right? Another thing about Dirac, the Dirac approach contains the answer to understanding how a gapless edge emerges from a gapful topological insulator if the system is topologically non-trivial, right? So suppose we have a topological insulator, we know there is a gap, and now we want to attach a boundary to it. And we know there must be some zero, I mean, some gapless state at the boundary. So from the Dirac approach, we can, in convenient terms, describe how this goes. And let me just give you the idea, not the technical details. The idea is always the same. So, and I want to develop the idea on the case of the two-dimensional anomalous quantum Hall effect, the quantum Hall effect Hamiltonian we had. So remember, the quantum Hall effect Hamiltonian was, I mean, had this structure sine k, sine kx, sine ky, and then some, this combination here. And, my finger is here. And now suppose we are close to criticality, means r equals close to 2. At 2, something happened. That was the situation where we jumped from everybody pointing up to a hedgehog. So let's now put an analogy to what we had before. R equals 2 plus m, and m is a small parameter. Small non-managing parameter, we know that m equals m positive is then topological, m negative is non-topological. So we plug it in and we linearize everything else. So sine kx becomes now kx, sine ky becomes ky, and these are already of second order. We throw them away, remembering that we can use them to regularize if we need them. So then we get a simple two-dimensional Dirac Hamiltonian, which can be written as in a certain representation is kx sigma z plus ky sigma y plus m sigma x. I relabeled here two Pauli matrices. I just gave them different names, the Paulis, for convenience. You will see in a second why. But I can what sigma x and sigma y is just a matter of names. I mean, I can call them differently just to arrive at more convenient formulas later. So that is now really a two-dimensional massive Dirac which describes the critical physics of the anomalous quantum Hall. Yeah? Are you with me? No? Good. Okay. Now, let's suppose we have a boundary. So suppose in real space, we have here we have m smaller 0. That means here is a topologically non-trivial anomalous quantum Hall system. And then at y equals 0, we put a boundary. And everywhere to the left of the boundary, we consider an m larger 0 system. So it's physically an interface between two different regions. No? Now, in order to make this better behaved, I consider a small an adiabatic tuning. I mean, for large negative values, I have some, say, m equals something, and then I slowly tune it through 0 to something negative. And that's how I model the interface. What we know physically, or what we expect, is that at the interface, in the vicinity of the interface, I should get some states along the x direction, which are linearly dispersive, some, in this case, chiral boundary states, some edge modes, in fact, quantum Hall modes, which propagate in one direction here along the boundary. And they will be the gapless modes of this insulator. So how do we get this from the Dirac picture? We do it as follows, and that's why I introduced this relabeling of Pauli matrices. We write our Pauli matrix Hamiltonian in concrete terms in this way. So this is a 2x2 structure. In x direction, the system is fully translational invariant, so I keep my x momentum. Or in other words, my eigenstates now are plane waves in x direction. They keep to be plane waves in x direction. And in y direction, I know that m adiabatically changes from positive to negative values across the interface. So here I don't write ky because the system is not translational invariant. I go to the coordinate representation in y direction. Okay? That's rewriting the Schrödinger equation, describing the boundary. So if you look into this problem, and I gave you the details here, but I don't want to go through this now. And if you just describe now such a ramp crossing through zero, you will always find a zero energy eigenstate of the y problem. I mean, the problem is separable in x and y coordinates. There is always a zero energy eigenstate of the y coordinate problem. The corresponding one-dimensional Schrödinger equation in this direction has a zero energy state, and there is an index theorem, so-called, which stabilizes this. So no matter how it looks, if you have a crossing of this parameter, you get your zero energy state. In a simple case here, where this is, the details are here, I mean, you can test it. If this is a linear ramp, what you get is a harmonic oscillator function. Zero energy harmonic, shifted by this one half of a non-harmonic oscillator, but you just get it. And what you are then left with is the eigenvalue of the problem in x direction, which is just kx, a linear dispersion in x. So this zero energy function times this plane wave, these are the gapless modes at the boundary. And they exist whenever you have such an interface. No? Is the construction clear? Yeah? So make your mass, the mass which is the critical parameter in this case, make it spatially dependent, tune it through zero to describe, to model a boundary. And we always do it in practice. I mean, if there is some kind of A2 topological insulator surface and ferromagnet superconductor, whatever, write the Dirac Hamiltonian, play with such adiabatically changing masses, and you get your states. And usually in simple terms. I mean, defining this as simply. Good. No questions? Yeah?
What is happening is clear, but I lost the one we get
Oh, I just relabeled them because.
Why kx is doing that with sigma x or tau z? So sigma z or tau z? I mean, if I look at the.
Because I miswrote it probably. This is sigma z. It's actually not readable, so that's a wildcard. This should be.
But you have it on the main diagonal with opposite sign, so it's tau z. When you write down the value.
Yeah, that is z here, right?
Yes.
That's okay. No, I redefined them. I did a unitary transformation, sending kx to kz.
Ah, but was originally x?
Yeah. It's just because in this case, the zero energy eigenfunction will just be will have one component zero for calculation's sake. But it's good that you mentioned it, but it's a detail. Yeah. I mean, details away, the thing to remember is whenever you have such a quantum critical point in the Dirac description, you tune your mass across the interface, you have a zero energy eigenfunction in the coordinate direction perpendicular to the interface, and the direction perpendicular to it gives you, describes the zero modes, or the soft modes. So last thing, why Dirac is great, and then we're done, actually. Remember the periodic table, these diagonals, that this structure here, yeah? That you can ask yourself, where do these diagonals come from? And a more physically motivated question is, why is it useful to know these diagonal structures? And the answer to that lies in the... an answer can be derived from the Dirac approach in terms of what is called dimensional reduction. And it's very simple, again. And again, I illustrate it on an example. So if we look into the table, we just saw it. I mean, we have, between A3 and A, we have such a diagonal business going on. And we saw it in our examples when A3, the Zuschrieffer-Hegger, can be topologically non-trivial in one dimension. It is topologically empty in zero dimensions. Class A, the quantum hole, is topologically trivial in two dimensions and empty in one dimension. But there is a diagonal correspondence between these two. And this we can understand by looking at our example again. And it goes like this. Suppose we take our two-dimensional quantum anomalous hole, which we just had, I mean, previous example, 2D quantum anomalous hole, two dimensions, x and y, and we write down the Hamiltonian again. And what I do now is, or what is on the back of my mind, I want to compactify the system, I want to go to an anisotropic situation. It's topology, right? I can do violence to the system. As long as I don't close gaps, everything is allowed. So I take it and I roll it up. And now I compactify it. I make out of this two-dimensional sheet a very thin cylinder. So what happens is the cylinder is 5 light years long here in this direction. So it's extremely long. We are close to criticality. So let me linearize in this x direction. But in the y direction, where I wrapped it up, I definitely should not linearize. I mean, there is massive size quantization because the system is so thin. So I have to keep the sign here, which is in the Hamiltonian. And the same in the third component to the Hamiltonian, which is now 1 plus m in small units. M describes the distance to criticality minus the cosine y. The cosine x became a 1. It's gone. So that is the Hamiltonian describing here this idealized situation. And now let's agree that we go to, are interested in very low energy scales, the smallest of energy scales, much smaller than the inverse size quantization corresponding to the cylinder. In concrete terms, this means that here we should keep only the zero momentum in y direction, because the next momentum will be 2 pi over circumference, and that gives us already some large value. Yeah? So if we're interested in the smallest of energy scales, we can simply cross this out, and this becomes 1. And if we do that, we go to kx sigma x plus m sigma z, and this is the Hamiltonian of the SSH. This was, remember, there was an SSH Hamiltonian. We linearized, it had exactly this structure, a one-dimensional Hamiltonian. So what this tells us is that there is a topological correspondence between a two-dimensional system of class A, there is no symmetries here, and a one-dimensional system, which is chiral. This one anti-commutes with sigma y. So, and since all I did in quotes was, I mean, wrapping up something and, I mean, and playing, deforming it a little bit, the topologies must be the same. So when this system is topological, so is this. And the winding numbers are the same. And that explains us why, as far as topology is concerned, there's essentially no difference in this direction. So these games can be played and for all symmetry classes, and it has been done, or it should, somehow I should communicate the reference to you. There's a great paper, maybe not the easiest to read, but still great, where all this classification business is explained by Ludwig, Rio, Schneider, somebody else, I forgot somebody, but a 2010 paper all the diagonal correspondences, including for the Z2 insulators, are explained in terms of Dirac language. And that's incredibly useful to know when you work with a concrete, in your own life, with a concrete insulator, Dirac it and try to squeeze it into this scheme. And one gets a lot of useful information. So, yeah, these were the four strong points of the Dirac approach. Contains more or less the full information on topology. It is nicely regularized. It describes boundaries well. And it describes these geometric bulk structures. So, I mean, one couldn't ask for much more. Except for one point, which don't be scared. I mean, we'll not touch it. But still, let me mention it. All what we did so far uses momentum space, right? Always K space. Now, you can ask yourself, in a real system, I may have some imperfections, there may be some geometric distortions, there may be incommensurability in potentials, or there is disorder. And whatever I do in this way, there is no momentum space anymore. So K space is gone. So whenever we want to describe such real space systems, I mean systems where momentum space is no longer a good concept to work with, translational invariance is gone, we can still argue that it's still topology. Topology doesn't care whether you put some impurities or not. Yeah? So there must be alternative ways of describing topology in a more real space-oriented way. And there are two approaches to that. Number one is scattering theory. I noticed there are some people from Berlin here. Berlin is the capital in this regard, so if you're interested in that, ask the Berlin guys. Right, Piet Brauer students here? Ah, here, there's one. So ask him, he must know. There's an alternative approach which I love, but I don't know, which is based on some gauge theory. So if there are some mathematically inclined or field theory inclined people, you can ask me. I mean, there's a beautiful approach which translates the symmetries into gauge structures, and you get from there the topology without ever mentioning momentum space. So it's ultra general. But I guess everybody is now really fed up. I'll stop here. Okay, thanks. You get a Z because you can go to many channels. If you take a multi-channel SSH in this checkerboard, sublevel structure, then the number is maximum number you get is given by the number of channels. That's why it's Z, you know.
Yeah.
Just get a second. So with interactions, what happens to this, the Z of the A3? With interactions, what happens to the Z of the A3? Do you know?
With what?
Interactions, what happens to the Z of the A3 in one dimension?
I don't know. I think it's fragile, but I just don't know. I mean, we all know this C to B8, but...
Right, but that's BD1, right?
Exactly. Yeah, so I don't know what A3...
I'm from
Max Planck Institute, and was in your talk. I know. Was in your talk in Max Planck.